Hello and welcome to Norwegian Woods. In this one, I'm out on a little day hike, and I want to try out some different way to start a fire. So I brought with me a few different gadgets and tools to make some fire. So hopefully, both you and I will learn maybe a little bit. I got the inspiration to make this video from watching another YouTube channel. It's called Knife Gun Guy. I'll put a link in the description. And he did all these different kinds of fire starting methods, and most of them I've tried a few times before, but some of them is entirely new to me, so it will be interesting to see how this works out. And I'm not going to make a full-blown fire from all of these techniques. Some of them I just want to make a little amber that's sustainable enough, so it would be possible to make a fire from it. It's just to try out the techniques. So I guess I just start off with the usual suspects. I guess that the easiest way to make a fire is just with a regular fire lighter. It's something I guess pretty much everyone can learn right away. It's not difficult at all. It's just to turn this wheel and let the gas through, and it lights right away, real easy. And there are a few different kinds of lighters like this. This is pretty much like the big lighters I see everyone talking about on YouTube. It's a gas-filled container down here, and a little valve. You push this and let the gas out, and have this wheel that turns on a tiny little ferrocerium rod inside, and this spark ignites the gas. So that's the easy way, maybe the best way, I don't know. There's also lighters like this that works in the same way, but they have instead of the ferrocerium rod, they have a little electrical device inside that creates a little spark when you push this this down. The valve operates like you push it down, you start to let out the gas, and when the gas is running, the little spark is jumping from one point over to the little pipe where the gas comes out. And I think this kind of lighter is a little bit less reliable than this one, because it's a little bit more sensitive to wind and wetness and stuff like this. This little spark is a little bit more fragile than the big sparks from this turning this wheel. There's also this kind of lighters. It's like a little blowtorch. I don't think you can see the flame. It burns quite a bit hotter than this, because it's a little bit more pressure, and the valve that lets
lets the gas out, it creates a little bit more flow on the gas on the way out. So, and this little blowtorch also uses some kind of ignition device, like this white lighter. It creates a little spark, little electrical spark inside. And this is the lighter I usually carry when I'm out in the woods, because it's always super easy to light a fire with it. One of the things with a lighter like this is that the flame, it points upwards. It's not pointing, it's just flowing so slowly, so it just move the way of the heat. With a little torch like this, the flame points exactly the way you turn it, so you can make the flame go straight down. And you can't do that with this without burning yourself. So this gives a little bit more control over the direction of the flame, and that and the fact that it's also a little bit hotter in the flame makes this a little bit easier to use. There's also this Zippo lighters. That's kind of nice, because they can use all different kinds of fuel. There's this cotton material inside this metal container, and you just take some kind of flammable liquid, soak this cotton material pretty good, and then put it back in, and you have the same operation as you have on this lighter. There's a little ferrocedium rod. And this is actually inside this little cylinder, so you can unscrew this little screw and change it when you've used it. And this burns like a little candle. It's a nice little fire making device, I think. This has a little bit of the disadvantage as this kind of lighter, because it's burning slow, so the flame always tend to move upwards. So if you want to light something that's underneath the lighter, it can be a little problem. I guess you can just lie it beside it, and or you can try to get it underneath, so it shouldn't be a problem, but I just wanted to mention it. And a lighter like this is you can just use it as long as there's still some gas in it. It's not possible to refill this lighter. There are some similar lighters that you can put gas inside, but a lighter like this red one I carry, I have this little bottle of gas that I can just refill it when it's empty. And the same goes for this one, as I showed you. It's possible to refill it when it's empty. This can use, obviously, a lot of different kinds of fuel, so it can be a little bit more diverse in a way. But I guess all of these firelighters will do the job. They're all good, good and easy ways of creating fire. Another traditional fire starter is the match. It's been available for a very long time, and it comes in some different varieties. This is the regular Norwegian kind, so it's easy, just strike it and it catches flame. This particular kind of match, you have to strike against this material on the side of the matchbox. But there are also some kinds of matches that you can strike anywhere and it catches fire. I guess it contains some of this material inside the actual match. And as you can see on this match, it's the fire starting material is not very big, so this this relies on that the actual wood in the match and catches fire, so you can use it. And it's also a little bit of a technique. So if you hold it like this and try to strike it, it's a chance that the match will break. So the best way you can do is to support the match close to the tip when you strike it, like this. And you can also, it goes out quite easily. So it's a little bit, what can you say? Sensitive to wind. And if the match is wet, it doesn't work. Not this anyway. A little while ago, I bought a box like this from the eBay. And it's different kinds of matches. It's I'd say it's all weather kind of matches. So it's you can compare this to the regular one, and you can see that the fire starting material goes a very very long way. And it's also covered in some kind of I think it's kind of wax, so it's water resistant. So these matches are I think maybe a little bit more reliable, but you can try to strike it and see what happens. You see, it gives you a lot more time to light your fire without relying on the wood in the match to actually catch. Compared to this, it burns out really quick. So another really popular fire starter in all of the bushcraft and camping and survival and hunting and everything environment is the fire steel. And it's a quite good little invention. You just scrape it and sparks fly off it, and it's really robust, and it's not so sensitive to moisture and wind and some of the other devices I tried it today. There are a few different kinds of fire steels, or ferrocedium rods or ferro rods or whatever you want to call it. And mostly it's due to the different metals inside the mixture of the actual rod. Some of them has quite high contents of iron, and that creates a little bit hotter sparks. And some have a little bit more magnesium, and that makes the sparks burn a little bit longer. So it's different flavors I don't know which one's the best. And I guess the one I have here is a little bit on the high iron content side of the business, I guess. It's a little bit of a technique to make it work, but it's quite easy to get some hot sparks. Just yeah, there it goes. It's no, it doesn't. I should have fluffed it up a little bit, so it's it takes the sparks a little bit better. But it's a good little device, and it lasts quite a few a few fires. It's not like matches or a fire lighter. There's also another kind of style of this that's a little bit popular. Is this? Is it has a ferro rod on the side there, and the one on this actual model is a little bit on the soft side, so I haven't used it so much. It wears down pretty easy, so I guess it's fairly high in the magnesium content. And the block that it's attached to is actually pure magnesium. So what you can do with this is to scrape off a little pile of magnesium and ignite it with a ferro rod. I'll try to demonstrate here. Make some shavings with some sharp edge. There's a little pile of magnesium, and this can be ignited with the ferro rod. I use this one. See, it burns. This one burns pretty quickly. It was pretty fine shavings, but it burns with a really, really hot flame, and that can be a good help when you want to start a fire. Another great source of heat is the sun, and there are a few different ways you can actually capture the energy of the sun in a way that you can make it into a fire. And today I brought two little devices that will make me able to do that. And the first one is just a cheap little magnifying glass. And the second one I'm going to try is the reflector of this flashlight. So let's see how this works out. I remember when I was a little kid, I got my hands on a cheap little magnifying glass, and I used to walk around and put stuff on fire. And the way this works, you see, the distance from the lens down to the surface. If you change this, you can focus this little point of light into a really hot little spot. And this you can use to generate some fire. Right here, I put a little piece of char cloth. Let's see if I can make it glow. Oh yeah.
It's glowing.
And this can be put into some kind of bird's nest or something like that. And blown into a fire. The second method to use the sun is to try to use the reflector lens inside this this flashlight. Let's see if I can get it off. Let's see. This is the part I want to use. See, this is curved, so it does the same thing as the magnifying glass in a way. It can focus the beam inside there. So what I just did, I took point this directly to the sun, and I have this little piece of chalk cloth in here. Focus point inside this reflector is really close to the bottom of the little bowl. Yeah, there it's going. Another cool method you can use to light a fire is with a battery and some steel wool. This battery is a 9 volt, standard 9 volt, and the steel wool is the 40 fineness, so it's really, really fine. It's a polishing steel wool, and the way you do this, It's really simple. You just short out the two poles on the battery, and it generates fire in the steel wool. See, it starts right away. See, it's burning. So. You can just put this little burning steel wool inside the bird's nest and some other flammable materials, and you can blow it into a flame. It's really easy. See, it starts glowing right away when you put the steel wool against the battery poles. So that's another cool option. Instead of the steel wool, you can also use some kind of aluminium foil or something like this. This is, I think this is the easiest. So, should try it out. What you see here is also a fire starter. It's called a fire piston. And how this works is, this is a hollow tube that's stopped in the end, and this is the actual piston that goes inside this. It fits inside, and it has this rubber seal around the tip, and it has a little dent where you can put in some char cloth or some other material that catches a spark really easy. And what you do, you just put this inside like this, and You give it a pretty good whack. You hit it against some solid surface. And what this does, it pushes this piston up into the this tube, and the pressure rises, and this also rises the temperature. So it's a little bit like a diesel engine. This compresses the air inside until the point that a little shark cloth or other material you have put inside this little dent actually catches a spark. To get this fire piston going, there are a few small things you have to do first. First you take a little bit of lubricant and put on the seal and the sides of this piston, so it runs smoothly inside this this tube. And next step, take a little bit of char cloth and put inside this little dent. Like so. And you put it in just a little bit. And you have to give it a really good whack to get enough pressure inside this little tube. Sometimes this piston jumps out, but we'll see. No. No. Smoking, but there it goes. Now you can hit it with the hand, and you can just try to do it like this. And I got a little amber. Oh. To get an amber now, I had to do this a few times, and I find it a little bit hard. I don't it works, but it's a little bit difficult to I think to get a reliable amber with this device, but it's doable, definitely, and it's a nice thing to try.
And move into a little bit more of the traditional ways. I have this flint and steel. I have a little bit problem with finding flint in my area, but there are a little bit. I can go down to the shorelines of the fjord next to Halden and find this little round pieces of flint. That's been, I think it's been lying there since the Ice Age. It's just some, you see, there are just little pebbles like this. But I managed to just break it. And this creates some nice sparks with a proper fire steel. So try to create a little amber. I take a little bit of this char cloth and put it on a flat spot on top here. And there's a sharp edge on the little flint pebble that I will try to hit with the side of my fire steel. And hopefully this will chip off a little bit of the fire steel, and this will turn into a little amber that will catch on my char cloth. Ah,
it's a little bit difficult to do it down there, but there, I got it. It's burning. So this could be just put into a little bird's nest and blown into a fire. Fire and steel. I guess this method has been used in this area for a very long time. If you can't find flint, you can actually use some other hard rocks like quartz or something like that. It's possible. Another way of starting fires is friction. The rubbing between two pieces of wood, which creates a lot of heat. This is actually my first try ever in my whole life to do this kind of thing. So I made myself a little bit of pieces and a bow like this, and I have this board that I'm going to put on the ground. I also wanted to try to catch a little bit later the amber with a piece of bark, and I have this spindle that I'm going to put. It's actually going to move back and forth like this and create the friction and the heat down there. And I have this piece of wood that I'm going to put on the other side to give it pressure down. So we'll see how this goes. I'm getting smoke in the wrong end. I'm going to sharpen it a little bit to get less friction in this side of the spindle. It's pretty sharp. Also, you put a little bit of lubrication in there, a little bit of Vaseline, and see if that helps. It's getting hot at the bottom as well, but more so at the top. The wood I've used for this is actually spruce, and this top one is a pretty green piece of birch. I'll try to make a new hole and see if. I've seen some people put some green leaves in there, so... maybe I'll try that. Let's see. Green leaf. Might work. I don't know. As I said, it's my first time. It's still smoking on the wrong side. Yeah, I got some. Friction on the right side. Okay, so I made a little wedge in there. And hopefully this will be enough to collect some dust. Oh. Smoking. It's hard work. It's an amber. It's my first friction fire amber in my whole life. So it was a little bit of a work, but this is a good feeling. Oh.
I guess if I had some materials to make a nice little bird's nest, this could be a campfire. There's obviously a few ways that you can make a friction fire like this with this twisting motion. One way is to have this a little bit longer stick and do the hand drill thing. And another way you can use, if you take off the string, just attach a handle on each side and hold this in your mouth and push down on this, and you can just pull sideways with the line. That's called Eskimo strap drill, but it's in principle it's exactly the same friction principle as this. The next kind of friction fire I want to try out is something I haven't seen that many do on the internet. So maybe it's because it's really, really difficult, or maybe it's just because it's not that well known. I don't know. I guess I'll find out if I try it. Maybe it's impossible to make it work. I don't know. So I have these two pieces of dead spruce. This is a flat surface, and this one I made kind of this shape in the end. And what I'm hoping to do here is to rub these two surfaces together, and this will create the friction and hopefully the heat. So maybe try like that. Just get a little groove going. Hang on. See a little bit of smoke. But there's not much dust collecting, so I can tell that it's generating heat. Maybe I'm doing something wrong. So I'm actually pretty worn out. I've been doing this for a while now, and it was a lot of work with a bow drill. So this is a method I have to check out more in the future. But this is the principle anyway. So when it comes to actually lighting a fire
I was taught as a kid that you should be able to use only one match to light a fire, and I think that can be a really good way to practice campfire starting, because if you can get the fire going with just one match like this, I guess all the other methods I've tried here today, and probably pretty much every method in the world will work, because one match, that's not really that much of fire. But we can try. I built a little bit of fire here with some birch bark and some other pieces of wood, so we can see if I manage to light it with my one match. This is all about how well prepared you are for the fire. It looks like my little one match fire worked out pretty good. It's soon warm enough so I can make myself a little bit of a lunch and boil some water for some coffee. That's good. So then I guess this day is coming to an end. It's soon dark, so I have to leave and find my car. But I think it's been a good day. Some of the things I tried was actually quite a bit harder than I thought it would be, but I guess that's a good thing, because then I got some skills to practice in the time to come. That's good. I'm pretty sure that there are a lot of other ways you can make fires. I know that there are certain chemicals that you can mix that actually make flames. And there are lots of other ways. I remember my dad, he told me when they worked in the woods back in the 70s, in the winter time, they always needed to have some make a fire when they had a lunch break. And often this was quite hard to get lit. And they didn't always have too many fire starting devices with them, but they brought of course the chainsaws, so they often use those to make fire. They just took out the spark plugs and put a little bit of gasoline in a spot where the little spark could ignite it, and that way they made the
fire in these woods, and I'm pretty sure there's so many other ways as well. Some of the stuff I tried today worked out, I think, really good, and some stuff didn't work, so what can I do? Practice more, I guess. So I think that's it for this time. So I really appreciate that you're watching my videos, and I hope to see you very soon. Thank you and bye bye.